Hi everyone, I hope you're all well. I am here to talk to you today about the history of policing on an international scale. So I'm just going to give you a quick outline of some of the key points about this. I've put this particular picture on the first slide that you can see here. I'm getting the hang of this now. It shows a police in history, I think in the UK, I'm pretty sure in the UK, they've got their top hats and their very smart uniforms and all of those types of things. The reason I have picked this picture is because the history of policing internationally has been seriously impacted by colonisation and the ways in which different countries have been colonised at different times. So I'll touch on that a little bit more later, but that is the key point that's influenced the ways in which policing has happened in history in particular. So how did formalised policing emerge, so to speak? It was very much around the sort of rise of the affluent consumer-focused society in the 1950s. They had other forms of policing before that, which I'll talk about more in a moment, but very much the formalised policing organisation that we know today sort of came out of the 1950s. In the UK, probably a little bit earlier, and originally the original ideas of policing being involved in general social administration and things like that definitely emerged from France and a couple of other areas there. So with the growth of property crime, policing became more important. There was, you know, a creation and proliferation of attractive and vulnerable criminal targets, cars, things like that, mass-produced consumer durables. So you could take them, then they'd be untraceable, they were anonymous, all of those types of things in this particular time. Not so much these days, but definitely then. And of course, the proliferation of these goods heightened the sense of deprivation amongst those who didn't have access to those material goods. So watching advertisements on TV, seeing these fabulous new products, and you couldn't afford to buy them, so people would often steal them. It's very much also a history of the global north in this respect. Now, I've put this picture down on the slide here, there, the red and blue picture. The blue you can see is what we talk about as the global north. The red you can see is what we talk about as the global south. So the blue, the ideas that we have about policing, they dominate the way that we think about policing across the whole world. So, for instance, there might be ways of doing policing that they talk about and develop in America, which seem to work quite well in some contexts. Then they, but that's very much a global north where people are, for the most part, affluent, even though there's still a lot of people living in poverty and things like that. But it's a developed nation, okay? Now, we often take those ideas from those developed nations and then we apply them in the global south. So we might take that that policing initiative and then say, oh, well, that'll work in Nigeria. Let's do it in Nigeria. And of course, it doesn't work in Nigeria because they have so many issues around poverty, and the crime that comes out of poverty is probably the leading concern. There's corruption in the police services in places like that because they are conflict ridden. There's so many things where, you know, even just the basic standard of in America, police come to your door and they don't often immediately shoot you. I'm not going to say always, but they certainly don't often immediately shoot you. Whereas in places like Nigeria, I'm so sorry about the drilling. The police come to your door and they can just shoot you. So just those little differences can make a huge difference to the way that policing happens across those areas. There are three models of policing, and I think the name of this person is Brodeur, but I have no clue because I am completely daft when it comes to names like that. I apologise. The first sort of major model of police that they Bourdieu talks about is the birth of the police, which is the French model. Police came out of France in about 1667 as a public institution, had a whole variety of duties, a very lowly status, which is similar to the colonial history here in Australia. They performed general types of surveillance, but also extremely broad. So when police go out and patrol, they're typically looking for different types of crime nowadays, and people will come up to them, you know, ask directions, or they might tell them about something they saw happening that was a bit weird, you know, those types of things. Whereas in this particular period of time, it was very different, regulated religion, morality, public health, food supplies, public roads, bridges, public buildings, safety, sciences and the liberal arts, commerce, factories and mechanical arts, servants and labourers, and the poor. These guys really did everything. It's quite huge and extraordinary to think that it is that massive. Anyway, shortly after that, we see the British model of policing emerging from a whole lot of political conflict that was happening at the time. But there's two ways of talking about this British model. There's what they call the orthodox or traditionalist perspective and the revisionist perspective. The orthodox traditionalist perspective said, you know, justified policing on the basis that there's massive social upheavals emerging around industrialization and, advanced urbanization, rising crime rates, weakened social bonds that used to regulate community life. We absolutely need policing. It's an overdue solution to an increase in property crime and disorder, and it was very much welcomed. So this is the, wow, policing's going to be great. It's going to be fantastic. It's going to save all of us. Like, this is what we all need. We have to have this, right? That's the traditionalist perspective. The revisionist perspective is a bit different, and probably the one that I align with a little bit in the way that I think about policing. But having said that, I'm certainly not a radical. I would argue that I cannot see a future without policing. So the revisionist perspective thinks differently about police. They look at police as an form of discipline and control of the industrial labour force, obviously, and the enforcement arm of the bourgeois state. So it's kind of working through a Marxist notion that policing is run by capitalists. And I don't tend to agree so much with those ideas, but it's certainly, it's an issue. And you can see that coming out in things like where, you know, who are policed is very important. We talked about this last week, where the that cartoon I used, we had the sort of middle to upper class people with their sipping champagne in the street. They weren't being touched at all by police. The homeless person sitting here with the bottle of alcohol in a bag is the one that the police interact with because they're seen to be the troublemakers, whereas the rich people with champagne flutes are left alone. They're not seen to be troublemakers. So in that sense, that the revisionist perspective is quite important because we can see that happening on an everyday basis in policing work. So they really stress the resistance that police were met with at various levels of British society when they first implemented it. They see police as a response to isolation, dislocation, alienation, and class division, but definitely not the best response. Peelian philosophies were really important. I'm not going to talk about these in great detail. There is a huge amount of information online about this, and I give you a little bit more of this discussion in the online stuff for you. But very much shifted the thinking about policing as not necessarily regulating every element of local life, which is that very early policing model that we saw, but instead as, you know, purveyors of criminal offenders to the justice system. So it's a substantial shift that we saw in the way that this happened. The third sort of model of policing that Bourdieu, or major movement that he talks about in his work, is the importation of the English model to North America, and the ways in which then this headed into, you know, policing US cities and the countryside, The fact that it was the responsibility of a whole mixed group of different people, constables, sheriffs, marshals, various auxiliaries, thief takers, bounty hunters, blah, 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 etc. So it was a fairly substantial amount of stuff that was happening. And we saw the proliferation of policing officers and different types of people involved in police work, and I would argue we're still seeing that in things like polarisation and so forth. But this often meant that strangers were policing strangers, and this is really fascinating stuff that Mark Finlay talks about. I think it's Mark Finlay. I've probably forgotten his name. Apologies, folks. Colonial work was largely the work of state or elite commercial and political interests which supported and maintained the government. So that's why there was, you know, a huge police crackdown on Aboriginal resistance to colonisation, because they saw, well, you know, we have to protect the commercial interests. We need to protect the land owners, even though they didn't own the land. The First Nations people owned the land. All of those types of things. This has led to compromises in maintaining the rule of law, either in the context of consent and coercion, the constant delegitimating of Aboriginal and Indigenous customs, and the fact that this competes with their local understandings of community social order that they have. And, of course, we see the perpetuation of exported inequality, which is the byproduct of legal systems created in developed nations and then being applied just across the board without any thought in colonisation contexts. This was something that Finlay talks about in Australia in particular, but it certainly rings true for a lot of international contexts around policing. Okay, so I just wanted to quickly touch on these different places in the world and how police emerged internationally. Depending on what the place is, really depends on how much information we've got about it. There are areas where we don't really have much information at all, but I'll do my best just to give you a little bit of a cap around each of them. Apologies, folks, I'm quite thirsty today. So in Africa, policing happened very much before European colonisation. They used things like supernatural methods, villagers, hunters, warriors, oracle priests, all of them in some way or another maintained order or carried out arrest and detention, interrogation practices, etc., etc. When colonisation happened, things happened very differently, and we saw paramilitary European ways of doing policing sort of emerged out of France in particular, be applied to these contexts. Local policing continued in some places and moved to European ways in others. This was really, it was a very important shift, because you can see in this picture the some African people in police uniforms who were obviously part of the constabulary at that particular time. Now, in the colonisation processes in those areas, again, it was just wholesale genocide, exactly the same as what happened here in Australia. Again, it's probably not so much been acknowledged in those nations at this particular point. But the police in those contexts had huge amounts of discretionary power to do whatever they saw fit, including, you know, if slaves were caught stealing, they would cut off their hands and feet. It was really brutal. Again, not the best sort of reading material overall if you have a weak stomach. So again, we can see the role of colonisation here in this particular context. China was a little bit different. They had, they talk about police as being made up of two characters, Jing and Cha. And I've probably said those wrong because, again, I'm completely hopeless with pronunciation. Jing or Ying, perhaps, means to warn. Cha means to be subject to supervision. So the combination of these two things created policing in China. But it changed under different emperors and at different times. It's hugely complex, and they have whole books dedicated to their histories. But Emperor Shun did quite a lot of work, established 9 kinds of what they called different officials, and 2 of these officials were police. There were Sichu, who were responsible for resolving disputes and maintaining order, and of course Shi, who were responsible for policing borders, investigating crime, and maintaining prisons and so forth. So did quite broad roles across China. France, of course, is where some of the original policing ideas came from. Policing was very much a municipal matter, so it happened right down at the local level up until World War II, but then they centralised at that particular point. They adopted a state military model, which is very different. It's a very highly paramilitary policing model, inspired by early Irish policing models. So they have sort of a dual military and civilian police function, which is quite similar to what we see in a lot of war-torn and conflict zones in other areas around the world at the moment, in Israel and Syria and places like that. The revolution didn't so much change this. It was established in all cities and headed up by a police commissioner. So it was just centralised in that respect. In Germany, we can see that broad social administration role in the Ancien Régime. I think that's how you say it, but I wouldn't have a clue. So they looked after welfare of people. They looked after the economic and administrative functions of the state. With the fall of the Ancien Régime, the wars with France led to a very similar style of paramilitary policing that they have over there. It persists to the current day. Japan was a little bit different. They had a centralised rule that was under the Tokugawa, again, really sorry about that, shoguns, which the Edo era, they had a very sophisticated policing apparatus. This is where it sort of emerged with this sort of samurai or warrior class that administered policing. And neighbourhood groups had, there were 5 different households that were responsible for order and maintenance. So in a lot of ways it kind of reflected a neighbourhood watch approach in the way that it was run. When the shogunate collapsed, the emperor was restored, and it was influenced by the highly centralised models that we see now in places like London and France and so forth, hence the Tokyo Metropolitan Police being created in the late 1800s. Latin America is very different indeed. We have very little understanding of how their policing apparatuses have been put together. I think there's a couple of books. I think I might be incorrect. I don't think there are any books around this. Colonization impacted very heavily on the ways in which these processes happened. We've got probably more history of the most recent discussions around it in relation to the revolution and so forth. But it was very obvious that the state and white elite cooperated in patrolling and in relation to crime control in the 1800s. And the formation of different states at this period of time meant a paramilitary style of policing, again, was adopted as the overall sort of best method, I suppose. Russia is an interesting one. It didn't have any dedicated policing groups prior to the 18th century. Various groups carried out policing and judicial functions together. I'm not even going to attempt to say that word because I am totally exhausted this morning. But it's a central investigative group within local crime-fighting units that work to control and regulate crime in different areas. And again, we saw a movement towards more centralised movement in the early 1800s. I think it's called the Gendarmes. the sort of paramilitary police units, again, very similar style. In the UK, police were very much amateur householders in medieval times. There were parish constables, full-time watchmen in the towns that would patrol a lot, and they had lots of power and discretion. Towards the Middle Ages, this shifted to a more justice of the peace approach, where police powers were handed to the justice of the peace to try and provide a bit of oversight of those processes, I think, more than anything. Oh, apologies, folks, I'm very tired today. In the 1750s, there was just a distinct move towards more localised, self-directed magistrates. They were uniformed and salaried and all of those types of things. And the later still, Sir Robert Peel, created the Metropolitan Police, and they had hugely expanded powers for their constables. Very much moved away from a policing as conflict model towards a policing as conflict resolution model, trying to negotiate model, those types of things. Nonetheless, huge resistance to that movement. Concentrated centralisation is very recent in the UK. Oops. The US was a bit different to the UK. It was about creating and sustaining boundaries between members of valued society and others. So it had a really localised focus. So the sheriffs worked in those localised communities from the top down, in the ways that they handled different issues. And you can kind of see this in the Western movies and things. They tend to portray them in a fairly stereotypical role. But nonetheless, the sheriffs really did. But they were the people that regulated and managed everything in the towns, and their, you know, deputies and so forth worked with them in the ways that they did that. Colonisation and immigration certainly had a major impact as well. Sheriffs and deputies became secular agents that were paid and charged with order maintenance. And, of course, police, as they did here in Australia, had a huge influence on the lives of First Nations people in the US. And thousands and thousands, if not more, much more than that, people were exterminated by police in wars, through the process of land dispossession and all of those types of things. And again, something that's not necessarily acknowledged in the current US system. Yes, I've got, my final slide says, wow, we've covered the whole globe this week. Probably not, but I've done my best to try and give you a snippet of what policing was like internationally in the past. I hope by the end of this lecture that you truly understand the impact that colonisation has had on policing processes and how important it is to think about histories and the way that they influence policing in the contemporary moment for groups such as Aboriginal people in Australia and First Nations people in other countries. It's also important to know that the stories of policing have not been captured very well because colonial powers didn't document them. And that, you know, historical policing has caused a lot of harm for First Nation peoples in different countries. But that about covers it for this little lecture. I hope that's helpful. And I'll chat to you all again next week. See you later.